So, welcome back to the WGLEU Season 4 Match Day 8. We have another game coming up for you today. Obviously, it's not over just yet. It's between Wusa and the Drooling Leprechauns. Germany against Finland. Not quite the game happening tonight overall, but still a good match nevertheless. And two teams that have been hit and miss with their performance. The Leprechauns sometimes looking very coherent, looking quite comprehensive, and Wusa having moments of looking like they're willing to adapt and overcome and, you know, really add new strategies, but not quite pulling them off just yet. Your thoughts on this matchup?
I think Wusa, they lack synergy, and Drooling Leprechauns, they lack direction. They don't really have very good aggressive tactics, and it lets them get breaking down very easily. I have to say, I think Wusa have been the stronger team of late. Drooling Leprechauns did fate school bus, so very hard to beat their Russian-Ukrainian mix, but I think Wusa might actually pick this one up.
Okay, so he's got faith in Wusa. But Melly, what about you as well? Coming in, we can see the lineup there. Is there any players you'll be looking out for? Because I remember in the airport we met up with, I believe it was Schnitzel actually, before we went out to the grand finals. So a player that you obviously got to know a little bit there. Any favourable side here, as you are kind of German, you know?
I mean, German, that's true. And I've heard rumors that Team Wusa want to make it quick regarding for the match tonight. But hopefully in their favor, we saw that they actually can if they want, and if they commit, and if they manage to execute well. But we've seen also different. And I don't want to point out certain players, but I think, as Ollie said, they lack synergy. They have to play as a team, and and that's like one of the main points where Wusa is failing. And well, we saw what they can achieve, and
definitely they have potential there.
Definitely.
Well, we have to see if that comes together here, because we are now moments away from getting to the game. But we can throw up that lineup once again, so you guys at home can have a little look. We did focus on Schnitzel before. We were actually in the same airport going out to the grand finals together, so we did have a good chat with him. Clearly not as cohesive as they once were, not quite the unit they used to be, but is there any players we need to keep our eyes on here?
I like Sieg and Kyuku because they came from a German team which has been pretty successful in the past. They actually split it up and fought Drooling Leprechauns. Kyrex is sitting up at the top of that table in the Hall of Fame. If you just head over to eu.wgleague.net and hit Hall of Fame at the top, you can see him right up there. Yep. Jack and Hoppy suit a very nice team in terms of individual skill, but again, they lack direction for this one.
Well, first map being Cliff, we're going to find out if anyone can bring that aggressive performance that we've seen doing very well for whichever team can kind of harness it better. We've seen the 3-2 split, which worked a little bit better in the previous game rather than the first. But then again, I like the all-in push coming from the south side. A little bit more aggression, a little bit more focus, fire. And the map, as symmetrical as it may be, there is a slight advantage in that aspect, as you explained previously. Predictions overall on Cliff. Who has the edge here?
I think Wusa does, honestly. I think they do. Drooling Leprechauns really struggled against School Bus here.
Do you know what? I think the Leprechauns are going to pull themselves together, and I think this is going to be their game. Sure. I think they're going to... I don't think that we'll really find out in this first map. I think both teams will be passive. I think maybe there'll be a try of aggression, but they'll back away from it. But all in all, I think it's going to be a draw on the first map.
Okay.
But in the end, the Leprechauns will pick it up. But our predictions aside, let's get our eyes set towards the first map. Cliff. Welcome to the first battle here. As promised, Cliff is the battlegrounds in the south in blue. It is Wusa, the German side, struggling to make an impact into this season just yet. But you never know, this could be their game. Well, he's backing them. I'm going to be going for the Drooling Leprechauns in the north in red. The Finns, who've shown moments of genius yet to fully enhance and kind of lock that one down. But what sort of tactics are we seeing from the very start here?
One of the greatest of spawns for those AMX-3090s. They're going to be a little bit late to the party at the beginning, but they'll still be before, as you can see, the Drooling Leprechauns side. as they do heading towards the middle. Message going for the initial kind of cliff area. The rest of the team just heading up around. And QQ, Seek in the middle as well. That's a pretty standard start for them. They're going to get the early damage onto those T69s.
Nice work from QQ there. A little bit aggressive, but he's making it work to an extent. Yuhu did get a tag towards him, so he's down to 908 and does get the follow-up shot as well. He's down a little lower, so good play initially coming out from these guys, but I want to see if they can really follow it up now. They've got the good damage to start with. One reply in so far. Is this the aggressive push coming out from Wooster, or are they just biding their time a little?
Well, you always have that advantage from the south at the beginning. You can get the shots on initially, but then it really does become how do you actually continue that momentum. FKK Schnitzel almost immediately gets punished. Yes, the T69 has more HP, 1,350, so 908, he's lost about 450 HP, and FKK Schnitzel lost about the same amount, about 500, 100 more. So not a big difference between the two teams, but pretty significant. If it does come to a really close engagement, 100% HP can make the difference between the win-loss at the end of the day. But still, because Wooster starting from the south, they have the more aggressive positions. They are in the better position, I think, in all. For me, the south is a better and an easier side to play on. It was actually different at some point from the north, so it was slightly easier. Stefan heading forwards now in his T69, trying to peek. But Dream Leprechauns have quite some firepower. You've got Jack on the right, the T69 further towards the right of him. That's just him indeed, my bad. And the rest of the team just sitting up below that hill. No one's going on towards the cliff. Obviously, that will start to happen as we do go through. Wooster have that option. Seek now heading on the rotate, though, in that MX1390. We see there's a lot from teams we saw in the previous matchup. But Muffety does get found, so Sheesh will be able to pick up the first frag in this matchup. So that tier 1 goes down. Not a big difference, but you know, tier 1s on this map quite often do get the draw, so you do want to take them down. But Dream Leprechauns now, they know they can go 4 versus 5 in the middle.
And let's see if they're going to commit to that just yet. We are seeing a little bit of a movement. Message has to now try and compensate for them losing Muppety there. So heading over towards the west side of this map, down that 1-2 line. He might spot out one of the tier 1s who did make his way forward. The Lux there will be spotted, surely taken down very soon. Message will hit this one eventually. There we go. So kind of reciprocates the early favor, but they've drawn, you know, a battle tank out position and made them commit a little bit further towards our west side. Whereas Sensei's still in the middle here in that T69. He does still have backup from Yuhu, but are we seeing any further aggression from Wooster, or are they still just being a little cautious after that first move?
Yeah, we're definitely seeing some aggression because they know that MX1390 is trying to get back into position. But Seek, I thought we'd go left and actually try and get the flank on, but he doesn't. He's going to go in support of the rest of his team. A little bit scared that Dream Leprechauns are going to push down and across, although wouldn't make sense because a message in that MX1390 team captain of Dream Leprechauns went down to try and deal with the Wooster tier on the Lux Muppety. And the Lux, only two frags of this game. FKK Schnitzel a little bit damaged, and so is Juhu. And the options for Wooster include basically what Seek is doing now, going forward to trying to get the shots onto the cross. And for Dream Leprechauns, it's basically fend that off and see if they can actually deal with the damage he can inflict and just get some of their own reciprocated.
Yeah, and I like this position from Yuhu, actually. Putting a T69 up here is quite a nice, unique play. Pretty much safe from the above road. It's very rare we'll see anyone get up there, especially with the gun depression to deal with it. But Seesh is heading over in that 1390, happy to be a little out on a limb. Good work from Jack there, finding QQ. So already a little bit of damage exchange, mostly against Wooster so far. And kind of evening the odds because Yuhu did get tagged up a little early on. So receiving one, well, now two shells as Seesh's position really came into effect there. Three shells actually eventually landing towards Yuhu. He's now down to 408. So looking a little worse for wear in this one. You can see him there having to be a little more careful. I do like this position, but easily undone by Seesh's. So got to be a little safer. Sensei obviously has a little bit more cover himself, so can play it smarter. But still, we are seeing finally a little bit of movement coming out from the likes of Snake Guy Finn in the tier one. Trying to secure a little more of this area because they know they're getting flak and pressure from it. But Message is actually joining in as well. So a bit of a commitment, and it's not worked out perfectly. Seesh's done phenomenal damage so far, picking up a good couple of shots. Message down at 573 now, and Seesh could be happy with his performance so far.
Yeah, he's been very good. I'm surprised Message actually went forwards, but FKK Schnitzel gets caught. Last shell doesn't land, it tracks him, but surely Dream Leprechauns are going to hit the penultimate one, and we see lots of engagement, but at the moment, Wooster definitely in the driving seat.
Yeah, Jack now receiving a little as well. This is not looking too pretty for the Leprechauns. The damage is coming back through. Jack needs to be a little more careful. Maybe overstaying is welcome to get a couple of those shots out. Stefan did kick into action with Comandante there. But at the end of the day, this is very much a tit-for-tat game. Every couple of shells made or connected gets replied somehow. No one yet has fully made a move. The most aggressive so far is probably Message and Snake Guy Finn moving up on the west side of this map using the 1-2 line, and you can see why that may be a mistake. Seesh is still there, picks up the kill in the end, and now Message is out on a limb here. He's got to be careful. He's pretty much unsupported. He knows Seesh is near, and actually he's now spotted out QQ as well. This could mean real trouble coming through.
Yeah, going to actually sandwich Message in there, and he has to try and get out of this one, but he has to fight for it at the same time.
Yeah, Message now taking on QQ. He doesn't have too much backup coming in. He's going to have to do this 1v1. QQ has the HP advantage, and he uses it perfectly. Comes in, gets a kill. Seesh appears in the end, so they get a good bit of information, but we are seeing the main battle now coming down. Sefan is pincered in, but Sensei moving in haphandedly there, gets caught out. Bit of a mistake from him. Yuhu not in there to help him out either. Kirex comes through. Stefan moves in. Stefan is low. Kirex looks to punish him. Doesn't get the shells connected. He's not even tracked and finally takes him down. And this is a sloppy battle. At the moment, Wusa have the numbers, but the damage coming in against them is in favor to the Leprechauns. Juhu's low. Sensei's low. But Sensei still staying alive is very surprising here. Commandante and Jack going back and forth. The T69's battling it through now. Jack takes one from the backside. See, still in a great spot here, and these guys are just waiting on that reload. Whoever gets it first will be getting these kills, and Jack falls to the hands of Commandante. Sensei not able to make the reply. Nice little double from Commandante. QQ comes in, saves him from Juhu, and this looks like an outstanding performance from Wusa.
They're doing brilliant focus fire. Kirex is still on 1.1k HP, and he's going to try and do some damage and get some tanks back.
Well, 1v5, he's going to have to do something pretty incredible here, but Commandante gets the first off, but there's the reply. Kirex finds the shot. Can he get the follow-up? Yes, he can. That is a two-shell takedown, but he needs to get these guys faster than this. He's tracked, he's held. There's nowhere to run, nowhere to hide. QQ is doing the damage now. One shot, he's one bounce, but it's QQ to land it in the end. And Wusa pick up the first map. I'm not sold on the tactics. It was a little slapdash, a little bit close. But it did come out in the end in favor to Wusa, and I think the defining factor to me was the focus fire towards the middle, Ben. Well played.
Yeah, and Message being out of position, completely down the bottom. He got focused out. I'm surprised Wusa actually didn't jump on that opportunity immediately, because yes, he was completely along the bottom. I'm not sure if they actually realized where the damage was coming from, because it was from Seesh above. And when you have the higher ground, you're always in the advantageous position. But Julian Leprechauns did a good job when they actually pushed in. They were in a 3v2. They managed to take down the tanks, but Kirex was completely in no man's land. He came in with 1.1 HK, which you never want to do in a firefight. You want to be spreading the HP around as many tanks as possible to keep guns in the game. I always talk about guns in the game, the most important factor for World of Tanks. As long as you have a gun in the game, it can do damage. It doesn't matter if you're on 1 HP or if you're on 1,100 HP for an AMX 3090. It's still 240 damage regardless. And Kirex just needed to be in there when his team needed him most. But he wasn't. And Message was down, so two tanks out. One of them dead, and one of them out of position.
And I've got to say, Seesh was absolutely phenomenal through that game as well. The man who got the initial damage done as well. Just constantly picking away at the opponents and never got caught out in an open position either, which is quite surprising considering this map is fairly open. It's fairly vast in that aspect. There's not as much cover as others. It's not a city map by any means. It's quite a defining open map in that aspect, and he played it very nicely, constantly chipping away at the HP, making it a little bit more viable. And let's imagine if, let's say, they didn't do that initial damage towards the opponents, they'd be in such of a disadvantageous position that I don't think they'd have won that overall. I think that in the end, maybe then, you know, it would have been the Leprechauns to execute a little better, get that, you know, a little bit more presence from, you know, the players who weren't quite in the fight like Kirex. But, you know, at the end of the day, Wusa did walk away with a good start to this one, and now we need to look towards map number two, because we haven't really seen Wusa having the advantage so far. So the best results they've had is coming off the back of a couple of losses.
Yep.
You know, I look at Kasna, for example, and a couple of games they picked up. Well, one game that they picked up. It's not been a stunning performance from them, but that's a good start. Now, Mines, I'd say, are more well-rounded maps, something that I've seen the Leprechauns doing well on. Could this be the changing point?
I'm not sure if Mines actually suits Wusa. Wusa's more of a team where they go for one direction of attack. They just go in one direction with all tanks, and it usually works for them. We saw it at WCG. We've seen it at the Grand Finals. It worked 50% of the time at WCG where they took second. Bit of a different lineup, a few changes.
Yeah.
So Mines, where you have to go on the hill and you have to look for the flanks a little bit more, you have to come from a couple of directions at least, could struggle for them. But beating Lucky Cracky, they were the better team, and Lucky Cracky is strong. We saw it in the previous matchup against Kasna. just about winning that one on the last map for Kaznacru. So being lucky, Cracky is no mean feat at all, but tank lineups are locking in right now. Triple AMX-3090, double T69, double T1 for Rusa. Standard stuff from them, although the T32, I would expect them to pick it up. And for Dream Leprechauns, triple AMX-3090, T32 times 2, 2 tier 1s. And Dream Leprechauns from the south. So it's going to be hard for Wooster to actually break this one because the T32 is going to sitting up behind the base and going hull down. We have to see if they can actually pressure them because so far teams have really struggled.
They certainly have. Wooster previously a team who did, you know, find some unique positioning. They, you know, put that player up on the hill before. They've tried to adapt this map. Didn't quite work out too well for them, but we're going to see how this one does. At the moment, obviously, Wooster do have the advantage. Let's see if they can keep that going as the next map is going to be Mines. Welcome to battle number two. Currently, Wooster one map up to the good. Can they keep that going, though? We are here on Mines, and Wooster will be starting in the north in blue. In the south in red, it's the team in their way. The Finns looking to cause an upset here, but I'm not sold by this. It looks like the Finns are going for that kind of lockdown that we've seen Kasna bring into the forefront, but what are Wooster doing?
They got the triple AMX-3090, so they've pretty much gone for the default hill push. From the north, that's what we'd expect, just going to get that early positional advantage. But against the T-32s, it's very hard for you to actually win this game. You have to really wonder if the IS-3 is actually a good tank to try and deal with those two T-32s. It's got the penetration and it's got the alpha damage just to sneak up past. Because if you have a look, basically the T-32s are there. You can already see messages spotted. There's another one just there behind the bush. The three MX-1390s, basically the only option is for them to come up down here. But then they have to go against hull down T-32s. Even if you could shoot the whole frontal hull, because the hull is more slanted, you basically have a harder time, my bad. You basically have a harder time, sticky keys for the win. if I actually go back on name, you basically have a harder time because the hull's slanted upwards and you can't penetrate, even if you do hear the front hull and you don't hear that turret. So very hard for them to get into this game. Message trying to sneak a couple of shots, and Drooling Leprechauns definitely not going to be aggressive in this matchup.
Yeah, so 8 minutes and 35 seconds here. Still a lot of time to be played with. We haven't really seen anyone breaking this strategy too well. I do vaguely recall a couple of teams focusing the push over on this side, taking down the players where Kirex and Juhu are and then working their way in. But it's never an easy one, and you've got to pull out something pretty impressive to do so. Not sure if we can see these guys doing it here. Wooster maybe not as confident. And then again, Wooster have no incentive, really, to go for a push on this. Let's say they draw it out, they still have the advantage. So I'm kind of surprised that the Leprechauns have gone for this passive stance rather than going for maybe something that could actually give them a victory here rather than a safety draw. I don't know why they'd assume that Wooster would go for an all-in push, because really that's just asking for trouble. There's no real necessity to do so for the German side. They can just sit in and go, okay, if you guys want to play this game, we'll keep the one map advantage and you guys can look towards the next map if that's what you really want to do. And is there any reason why Wooster would want to push against this?
Well, they might not have to. Message is coming down off that that hold down position, so it actually gives Wooster the advantage a little bit more, because it's impossible, as I said, pretty much impossible for a team to beat those two T-32s. Unless you're like Virtus Pro and you actually do manage to take the left side and you just find a way in from there and obviously keep the hill at least with the T-69s. But Message going to go hull down in the standard position towards the right where that rock is, and really does get spotted out early on as well, so he can't actually go that far forwards. But because the T-69s exist, there's no T-32. It's going to be hard for Wooster to actually deal with that tank. Doesn't matter really where it is. You really need the MX-3090s from behind, the T-69s from the back, because if you look at the side of the T-32, it's pretty much just big old tracks and a turret. You know, very easy to hit the tracks, which is disastrous if you're playing with a heat ammo-oriented tank, and that's obviously the T-69. But Wusa haven't really reacted to that T32. You can still see the T69s in the same positions. AMX1390s on the hills. Tier 1's keeping up the flanks and the looks, making sure there's no sneaky hill, not hill play, lighthouse island play. So very static. Dream Leprechauns, they need to be making the first move. But Wusa also has the option of making the move because they've got... They just need to make sure they spot the lighthouse and they see that there's resources for Dream Leprechauns there, and they basically do what Freefall did and just push off onto that T32.
I'm still not sold why they'd do so. There's no incentive. If I had an advantage, as we used to do, and a team was playing very passive, like the Leprechauns are, I'd be like, well, okay, we can play this game as well. If you want to bring your odds even lower, if you want to give yourself a harder task, that's okay by us. If maybe the Leprechauns feel this is such a strength for Wusa, then you sit back and then you play passively. Fair enough. But still, I'm not sold by this tactic. I feel this is one of the downfalls that Leprechauns genuinely have, is this lack of creativity when it comes to aggressive plays. They don't seem to have that kind of game plan to be able to fall back to when they go, okay, well, we didn't pick up the first map. Let's find a way to get back into the second here. Let's find, you know, something that we can surprise the opponents with, rather than, okay, we saw someone doing this before. It was very passive. We saw Kasna doing something very similar, and it paid off to an extent. Snake O'Finn has kind of moved around a little as well, but it's surprising for me because Finns in every other game I know have always been quite aggressive. They've played this quite, you know, ingenious game sometimes, but it doesn't seem as though the Leprechauns have kind of adopted their Finnish ways here. They're certainly not a Spiel in that aspect, and at the moment, it won't give them a game back here. So Sensei still keeping eyes on QQ just in case there is that dive off the hill. But as I said, I see no reason as to why Wusa would even make a bit of a game plan out of this. Let's take into account if they do go for that, you know, lighthouse island push. Yuhu is still here, right? So he's right at the front in the 1390 pretty much. He's got, you know, perfect eyes on, he'll spot someone out. Behind him is Kirex, spotting mostly the cross across the hill. And then even further back, you've still got Sensei. So 3-1390s play with the ability to turn another, and then you finally have these big T32s coming into place. Unless the Leprechauns make a move out of this, I don't see Wusa finding a response. But then again, we are seeing a little bit of movement from both. Snake Eye Finn did move up with Message, and they look like they want to go for a little bit of a cheeky engagement here. But Zeesh being spotted out might slow that one down, and it might reset the matter.
Both those tanks got spotted, both QQ and Zeesh. but what Wusa don't realize is it's not just Message there, it's Snake Eye Finn as well. So Wusa could make the wrong call and just post onto Message, expecting them to be one tank, and they actually find two, which would be pretty disastrous. Those AMX1390s didn't got really enough damage to deal with one, even if you have three of them. But Zeesh is going to be creeping his way up, gets Snake Guy Finn, finds Rufy. So first frag going towards Drunian Leprechauns, a little bit of an advantage, but not much on mines, not the most important tank in the world. But we are heading towards the 2 minute and 30 second mark, which is when teams start to push. Because, you know, if it's 2 minutes and 30 seconds, you can at least keep your tier one somewhere and actually end up losing and actually drawing it.
Yeah, and here comes that T32 play through the middle. We're not seeing any sort of resources put in the aspect of those 1390s. So Snake Eye Finn and Message both moving up, spotting out Zeesh, and I think Zeesh has probably spotted them as well. So a bit of a back and forth, and this may put Wusa in more of a defensive posture more than anything. Zeesh out on a limb here. He doesn't want to get caught out, obviously, but he doesn't know that the 1390s are yet to join. But they are mustering themselves together here in a slightly more aggressive stance, but not by much. But still, is there going to be a push out of this, or are they just toying with them, really?
I want to see the T69s actually make a move. Stefan Commandanta can actually... Stefan can just drive forwards and hit Message right in the side of the turret. But that would give away the game plan. They are going to go for it, though.
Yeah, but Snake Eye Finn is there. That's the problem that they weren't aware of until now. And a little bit of damage done. Nice work from Stefan to back away carefully in the T69. Not want to overcommit. Message and Snake Eye Finn can just lock down the center of the map. They are now seeing the join from the 1390. Sensei moving up with Kirex. So this could spell trouble. Sensei now crossing over. He's going to go straight in towards those 1390s. QQ is here. Schnitzel as well. And the Leprechauns are being taken down pretty damn swiftly at this moment. Kirex is low, Juhu is low, Sensei gets one back, QQ finds Kirex first. And now QQ is the focus of at least part of this split, but a 2v1 is not going to go well. Zeesh finding Juhu is going to make it so much harder, as now QQ and Schnitzel need to see if Message can get around the back. They must execute him fast, because now here comes Message. It's a 2v2, now a 3v2, it's a 2v1 again. Schnitzel is the last man standing up on this hill, pretty much for Wusa, and he's going to be caught in the heels. The two T32 twos are coming in to do some real damage. And look at that, Schnitzel can do nothing. Finally back up and running. Might just about make it away, but he doesn't. Snake, I think, catches him in the end. But it's still a 3v3 pretty much. But those two T-32s are massive in the game.
And they actually managed to track FKK Schnitzel there. That was basically the killing move for Wusa. I didn't expect him to be able to get alive, but, you know, it lasts a little bit longer, perhaps. Stefan on reload, pretty much Seeker as well. Commandanta and Stefan are the only two real damaging tanks for Wusa who can actually sustain and stay alive for a little bit. 1 minute and 1 second left. They have to deal with Stefan, who's Snake Eye Finn is an 834 HP, which is a bit, pretty much in the bounds of a T69's gun, T178. You can hit about 1,000 damage, but they are looking for Muppety, and he will find it. But kind of not a great frag.
It's not the one you'd want to pick up.
Not really the one you would want, especially since you can't cap, so a little bit pointless. And you can see there's T-32 is just sitting up on towards the hill, pretty much impossible to move.
Yeah, so all in all, we did see the Leprechauns getting close to fully committing here. 28 seconds left. I don't think there's that much time, really, to take these guys down. And the longer the clock goes on, the less likely it's getting. But to be fair, though, Commandante Kyra on the side, they've not spotted out yet. Message will be watching, and Message will get the first shot off. Commandante moving in, Seesh as well. They're committing with 13 seconds left. This could be a mistake, but it could go well. Snake Eye Finn goes low, he goes down. Now just Message alive, 8 seconds. Can they get down Message fast enough? 6 seconds, Message finds Seesh. Can they get the last couple of shells coming through? Stopping him from escaping, 1 second left. I don't think they've done it. Oh no, they didn't get the final shell through.
It was I'm not sure if it...
It didn't render.
The battle ended and the shell stopped flying. That's pretty much what happened. We've seen that twice today. This is pretty weird. I mean, really.
It's a rarity, let's say.
And Wusa came so close then. Why? Where was C? He should be on the hill.
I don't know. I don't care
if he has 48 HP. He should be on the hill.
He was there.
Was he?
Yeah.
Was he?
Yeah.
Okay, my bad.
He was the second guy there. You're giving him grief and he was the second guy there. How dare you? But still, that shot literally did come out on the last second and just before it connected. Thank God for the sake of the Leprechauns, because they would have been in more trouble. And this is what I don't understand. Why would you risk doing that play? Their endgame wasn't going to be a victory, let's be serious here, in those T-32s. Once they go onto that hill,
yeah.
I don't get it. I really don't. They played for a loss rather than a draw, which... Okay, at least they went aggressive to an extent, but in the wrong way. I'm a little bit baffled by that. You know, don't get me wrong, I'm not exactly a master tactician in this game, but if there's a difference for me between... At the point they pushed in, I feel it was either a loss or a draw. They were too passive to that point to ever make it out of there alive. Unless, you know, Wusa went absolutely mental and just went all in. Why would you make that push? You got two 2-32s. Is that ever going to be a pushing lineup?
Well, Na'Vi actually used that one against Virtus Pro and did win it. That's actually what won the grand finals. But Virtus Pro's lineup was a bit different, and it's Na'Vi.
And it's Na'Vi. Come on, you could give them tier ones. They'd probably still just win the game.
Exactly. Yeah, they had a choice, and they tried to get the element of surprise, but because the 3 MX-39s were also on the hill, it didn't work out.
Yeah.
But the T-32 did take down FKK Schnitzel, which, to be honest, drew up the map for them. You know, FKK Schnitzel getting tracked there where he did. Him dying, if he stayed alive, it would have been game over a lot earlier. But Steps is our next map, still 1-0 towards Wusa. Fourth map coming up now. Yep. Triple MX-3090, double T-9, double tier 1. I believe that's still from Steps, from
Mines,
so probably going to see something change a little bit.
So Steps coming up. I don't understand these teams and the tactics. I'm going to put it that way for now. The Leprechauns need a victory pretty soon. Let's be serious here. This is map number 3. They kind of need to get themselves going if they want to actually start picking up something towards a victory. Otherwise, they're going to pretty much hand over the advantage to Wusa going into the final maps. What options they have? Because Steps has been a map that we've seen coming down to a draw or a cap, pretty much. I don't think I've seen many kind of being decided at the moment by actual all-out battles. It's been down to caps, possibly, which has worked for some teams, let's bear in mind. Are either these teams got that ability here?
I've seen some impressive stuff from Wusa. Not at the beginning of the season, but they've kind of changed up a little bit on these open maps. So I think possibilities. Dream Leprechauns, a little bit passive, I have to say. But they can really do some fantastic stuff on this map. And they've gone for a pretty heavy lineup, but not all the way. And so is Wusa, to be honest, with the triple MX-3090, Pershing, and of course the T-32. Wusa going for triple MX-3090, double TC-9, I think. Maybe if KK Schnitzel, sometimes he plays the T-32, so he could pick that one up as well. Indeed he does. So double AMX 3090, double T32. I must admit, I do like the extra T69. I'm not a massive fan of the Pershing. I think it worked beforehand, but for the same reason the 416 doesn't work, the Pershing doesn't work, because this map is won and lost on, you know, being quick and decisive, and that's where the T69 is great, as opposed to the Pershing, which is very good as a turret. And if you do want to push in, you want the T69s by your side. You can see how much damage they did to those T32s.
It's true.
It just absolutely decimates teams.
Well, it's certainly an option, and well, let's see if the Druid and Leprechauns can pull anything out. They do need to. I'd say on paper they are still the better side here, and I think in the results it shows as well, but sure, they're not showing up really to the extent I expected at the moment. I'm hoping they can kind of bring out a little bit more aggressive play with the victory in this one. They've been kind of a little bit secondary to what Wooster's been doing, which is quite surprising, to be fair. Wooster at the moment still in the lead. You know, they're not playing a completely passive game, but we're going to have to see what they come up with this time, as Steps is the next map. So, welcome to battle number 3. Currently still Musa with the one map advantage. The Leprechauns yet to really show us too much in this game, but we can find out what they can bring here as we are now live into the map, as we will be seeing Wooster starting in the north in blue. In the south in red, it's going to be the Finnish Leprechauns looking maybe to shake something up, but so far I think we're seeing the normal beginning.
Yeah, Wooster not really the ones to innovate. CK heading towards the trench as pretty much the most of his team, and only the tier ones really staying in the middle. Okay, QQ in the MX-3090 also sitting up right in the center between those two tier ones. And for Dream Leprechauns, pretty much heading also towards the trench side. A little bit unusual. Sometimes we see more of the left side play. This could be indicative of a very quick map, actually, because often we see, actually, when both teams go over towards the trench, that one team usually does come off the better, and it does come down to a 5-5 Sieg. He's getting locked down a little bit. He's got to be careful. Peeks over to try and do some damage. We've seen this work out for Sieg play. Might not end up working out for Wooster, because, well, Druid Leprechauns know he's there, and they just have him absolutely locked down like an absolute treat.
And Kyrix, though, is out on a limb, though. I look at how far forward he is, and I'm a little bit worried. He could have got caught out there, but falling back a little bit. He's got the fire coming in from behind, so it kind of makes sense, but still, a little bit worrying when you're going out on your own like that in the 1390. But still, we saw an initial bit of glimmer of hope towards an aggressive game from these two, but that got swiftly turned around, and that M26 Pershing just being the turret, pretty much, as you mentioned. We are seeing finally Schnitzel appearing on the horizon. Snake Guy Finn eyeing it up in the T32. No shells made, though, and so far the only one really doing damage was the one towards Messenger in the 1390. Got taken down a little bit, down to 7-9-2. But still, from the very start, whose tactic do you prefer?
I think Wooster is a little bit more on the front foot, because from the north it's a little bit easier to play. But they are playing very passively, because you can see how many of their tanks are sitting right back. But it also gives them the option to flank around and actually come from the side, which is obviously a very good option on this map. But the look's heading down, so they do keep the spots along the trench all along here. Sieg is still in that position, so really Wooster can only stay over towards the trench side. If Sieg tries to get off, it's going to be a lot of damage towards him in a very short space of time. But we can see Message and Sensei in the two MX-3090s push down the middle. We've seen this a lot, actually, from both north and south, and it usually doesn't actually end up in anything. It's more of just trying to spot out and get the center of the map, trying to see if you can actually find anything there, but only Rufy will be found. But that's a good thing as well, because they can put some pressure on in the cap, maybe come from the behind and push into Wooster's flanks, which would be the best option for those AMX 1390s.
Yeah, Sensei Message still moving forward. Schnitzel appears upon the horizon, but that's just due to the fact I think Jack and Snake were pretty damn close. So Sensei still moving up, edging their way there quite carefully from cover to cover, so they don't want to give anything away at this point. Juhu as well has now joined them in the tier one. So a three-man squad pretty much heading out. Message playing a little bit more passively. Let's see where he's at. A little bit further behind, but not by much. But he's actually going to back away. So maybe not happy with what they found from this point, and they feel they need to retract a little bit further back. But they didn't actually spot out the tier one, which is quite surprising to me.
Yeah, but you can see the damage put onto Snake Guy Finn. 800 damage coming onto him. He's got to get into a better position. That T32 being caught out in a very desperate fashion. Now Message and Snake Guy Finn down to 700 odd HP. And that gives Wooster a definite edge in the firefight, but can they actually utilize it? That's where they struggled before. Kyuku heading forwards though, FKK Schnitzel already there. Commandante coming from behind as well. Looks obviously going to be the front runner in that tier one. They can still use him, dispose of him, and it won't make much of a difference.
Sure, that probably wouldn't be a bad plan. We are seeing that three-man squad of the 1390s heading out on their own. Now, whether or not they'll get caught out on their own time is different, but they can make a move towards the main cluster of HP, which is Jack and Snake Guy Finn. Pretty much uncontested here from the other firepower, or at least the battle tanks from the Leprechauns. Whether or not they're aware of this, we'll find out. But still, at the moment, the push does continue from those 1390s of Sensei Message, joined by the tier one of Yuhu towards the center of this map. But you know, it's going to be where does the fight come down to, and who made the smarter move in this?
Really does depend as well on Rufy. He gets the early spot on, actually, and he managed to get away, though, and Sensei just missing the shot there. So Stefan and QQ will be able to come back. Seek might join him as well. And Wooster's found a little bit of a weak point. Does Dream Leprechauns decide to rotate back around? I don't think they do. They're going to stay in the middle. Sensei finally gets taken down by Message. Rufy finally gets taken by Message even. And Kazna, Dream Leprechauns, going to have to be careful. They don't get caught in no man's land.
Yeah, they've split up their forces here. Both tier ones are actually over with these two 1390s. However, Message falling back. He feels as though maybe he needs to reinforce the two-man squad at the moment. Joined by Kyrex in the background. As you can see, those shells are coming in quite drastically. And also a question coming over for Wooster is, where do they put their attention towards the two to three tanks at the cap? And I think they're going to also split their attention both ways as well. This is going to be a little bit tough for teams that may have questionable focus fire at times, as it looks like these guys actually might be falling back. Only Muppety really sticking around with Sensei. The others are playing quite carefully, and they're teetering on the edge of actually making a push here. But you know, who's going to actually do the damage?
I don't know why they're not pushing. Both teams see a weakness. Wooster see two weaknesses. They got weakness there, and they got weakness here. It's really the perfect position for them to actually kill all of Druid and Leprechauns. You know, you see the team split completely down the middle. You just choose which side you want to push on with more tanks, and you win. Simple as that. But Wooster don't see it, and this is the problem for that team. There's no synergy. There's no thinking. They're just not making the right decisions. And it's kind of lackluster. They've still got 4 minutes left on the clock, so they are finally going to go for the northern push, not wanting to go in the kind of rocky, hilly areas where the MX-1390, which you can see Wooster relies on so much, pricking their two best players, QQ and Seek, on. A Message, actually, pretty far out. He's got to be careful.
Yeah, Message could be taken down here. Is the 1390, he does have backup. Sensei making his way back as well. These guys are falling back, but as you mentioned, Message could be in trouble here. Commandante is literally sending, he's behind, but he's been caught from Siege and QQ on the flank. One more shell will do it. Siege will land that one. So already a nice advantage being carved out by Wooster. And this is causing the rest of the Leprechauns to back away a little, try and play a little safer, because they did get caught out here, and they're still not in the best position to make a reply. They're split up a bit. They're not together in this one. And this is a vulnerable Leprechaun that could be taken to pieces if Wooster make the move.
What's going to happen for them, though? Seek is sneaking around a little bit. He's looking for some shots, and Snake Eye Finn has got his arse to them. He could be down.
Yeah, Snake Eye Finn got taken low early on, and now down to 424 HP. He's certainly a vulnerable target. You can see Seesh eyeing him up. Seesh will land the shell. One more would have done the job, but finally finds a touch of cover there to hide behind. But in the meantime, you can see the rest of Wooster moving in. Kyrex finally finds a position to get some shots down towards the opponents. Snake Guy Finn is still out on a limb here. He is going to be surrounded very soon. The HP is not high enough to be really doing anything with, but maybe to buy a little bit of time for the rest of his team to find better cover. He is now surrounded. Three players moving in. I don't know how they're not landing these shells. Oh my word, he is literally being the bait for these guys to try and peek out and do these shots. Somehow he's still alive. Commandante is not landing these. Finally, Schnitzel will take him down, but with all of that said and done, look at the damage coming back in towards Wooster. They fell for the bait. Sensei will punish. And look at the firing squad against the Wooster side. This is not looking pretty.
With FKK Schnitzel had to hit that first shot, but he fluffed it completely. No idea why he couldn't just deal with that one. He has to hit those kind of shots if he wants to be a top tier player. And now Wooster definitely not looking so pretty. Yes, okay, they've got one more fighting tank then drooling leprechauns, but they still have to get in the right positions. The one advantage they have right now is the fact that drooling leprechauns used all their shells to deal with FKK Schnitzel. That's a brilliant aspect of the T-32. Stefani's got to make this one count. Jack has got the Pershing, so he continues to do damage. The T-152E2M2, such a fantastic tank, such a fantastic gun in the right hands. Musa have to nail this one, 1 minute and 22 seconds.
Yeah, and you can see the situation they're in. Sensei and Jack have better positions. Kirex is up there on the high ground as well. The low ground, well, pretty much in the hands of Musa. They can't make a really consolidated push out of this one. 1 minute left. I don't think there's time for Musa to make a move, but they're in such a position that it's going to be very tough for them to do anything here. And they are still slowly but surely advancing towards the leprechauns, and I'm not sold by this.
No, and you can see the tier ones up on the left and the right. It's a draw, pretty much 100%. That's what Drooling Leprechauns are playing for. They're not giving them an edge. 45 seconds left on the clock. This is garbage time. Maybe not for Woosa, but I think for every betting man, only the cap can really happen. But QQ, we're going to be able to do some decent damage here. It's Sensei on reload.
Yeah, Sensei could be in trouble. He's going to try and back away. And the biggest threat is against Wusa. They're all quite low. If they actually went down here, they could be in trouble. But here we go. Kirex has found Stefan. So already the first move does come into place. QQ now takes a high ground. Sensei on the run. We know the Leprechauns have played their tier one safely. Jack, though, left on so much HP with Kirex. This is going to be a hard battle. But still, two tanks in the game for Wusa here. They could go down if they're not careful. Commandante and Seish, the last two alive. Commandante now surrounded. He's got two tanks. Sensei around the backside. Doesn't even go for the shot. 3 seconds left. This is another draw coming out between these two. And just lackluster play through and through.
Just poor performance from all. You know, Wusa, they saw the way in, basically. FKK Schnitzel had to hit that one shot against the T-32.
I don't know how he did
it. And he just
it.
Hits the center of the turret, exactly where you don't want to be going for. And that would have been okay. But what they should have really done is take the MX-30-90s and just send them around and come from behind and deal with the tier ones from Drooling Leprechauns. Come from both sides. But Drooling Leprechauns, they know how to draw that one map out. It would have been, even if they sent the MX-30-90s around, yep, very hard for them to win it because the higher ground and the bushes are there on top. So I'm not sure about why those bushes are there, because it gives you such a good overall plateau. Wooster did the same against Denali Esports, also managing to draw that one out. So another map drawn. We're heading into our fourth map now, which is going to be Ensk. Neither team looking particularly good, I have to say.
I completely agree, and this is quite saddening, because we've seen Wusa looking okay at times, and the Leprechauns both have had, you know, performances where you go, okay, they've got potential there. They're a team that could do well. And once again, when maybe they're not given such a on-the-plate opportunity by the opponents to make it happen, they just don't have the initiative to do so. And I feel that's being the biggest factor here. Neither of these teams are actually making a solid effort. If that sounds right, they're not actually going, okay, we've done this tactic, let's go for it. You know, I look back to the previous games and I look at Himmelsdorf, for example. It didn't go well for the team that made their all-in push, but they did it nevertheless because they thought it might work. They might have found a weakness. They saw maybe Schoolbus doing something similar. They wanted to adapt that into their own way. Okay, it needs a little bit of work there, maybe a little bit of polishing, maybe not such egotistical play on occasion, but confidence isn't necessarily a bad thing. You've got to try it to see if it works. And maybe there's times to do it in practice games, but at the moment, between these two, it looks like they haven't even done that. You know, they don't show the initiative that I've seen them having glimmers of hope of before. And it's a real shame being into, you know, match week 8 now, pretty much, and they're looking no better than when they started.
Yeah, they have to show some progress and some fruits for their labor. Simple as that. And they haven't. I think they are better than they started a little bit.
Maybe.
but it's a very hard call. And I think Wusa, they're still in the driving seat a little bit. The ability for Drooling Leprechauns to get back is narrowing by the map. You know, they've only got two maps left, map 4 and 5, for them to actually draw up and then take the map for their own to bring it to a 2-1 if they want to win it. Obviously, if it's a draw, then it can only be a draw. You get 1 point apiece. Not sure. I think Wusa have been okay on this map. They won against, I believe, Lucky Cracky also won against Kazna Crew. So a map they do well on, but they don't want to be picking those IS6s like they did against Virtus Pro, because that sucked.
If they go for that. I might just uninstall the game for them if they go for that. but we'll have to wait and see. As we said, Ensk is coming up next. First real city map we're seeing. And I don't get it. When we see these two teams play, even though they're not particularly decisive on open maps, they seem to like them anyway. They seem to pick these constantly as the first three, and I never quite understand why, when neither of them seem to have deciding tactics. When I used to see Dignitas at the time, Team Dignitas used to play quite uniquely. So they had that, the southern stack, when they literally put all their tanks in that small circle,
sure,
right at the back there. They, you know, teased them in with maybe a little bit of bait, you know, sitting out in an open area. I get it, you know, or Prokhorovka back in the days where we saw, you know, the kind of head-on-head clash before they used that small village. I also got that. But then when these teams just play it for the passive nature and then go for the wins, maybe luckily on the first three and then try and close it out on the last two, I'm like, why not try and at least, you know, bring a little bit of edge in the first couple of games, you know? Try and go for the victories, because these guys are playing so damn passively and it surprises me. You know, I look at Lucky Karaki, another new team to the league, who didn't win their games particularly well today. They didn't look as completely dominant as they did. Kasna did walk away with the edge in the end. But then again, they managed to challenge the number two seed in this. The top two team. They managed to get a good couple of maps off them. They looked dominant at times. And that makes you go, wow, okay, great new addition to the, you know, to the league. And then I look at these two and I'm like,
yeah,
what have you brought?
Yeah.
You know, and it's the new teams that sometimes bring out these little bits of genius that can completely change up the whole league. But when it's just this very passive, stale approach, I'm just like, well, I kind of want a little more from the guys. But are we seeing the ridiculous IS tanks coming out, or are we seeing
no,
a normal lineup?
I don't think Wusa, I think they've learned their lesson at this point in time. They are going for the double MX51 and triple IS3, double tier one, and the same goes for Dream Leprechauns, but with an extra MX51.
Well, let's see how that comes into effect, as we are now ready for the next map, Ensk. And welcome to battle number four, still between Wusa and the Drooling Leprechauns. No, it's not over yet. In the south in blue, it is Wusa, currently leading one map to the good in battle number four. So, can the Leprechauns finally wake up? A team who I'd say are substantially better on paper, but yet to really show it. And Wusa, not really showing much talent either, let's be serious here. But then again, what are we seeing so far from these two?
So the common trend for teams from the south is now going straight in towards that village. They've got the triple IS3s, like Lucky Karaki. They're going to do the same, pushing right up into their Sikh and going right. I believe Killer Pit's going to be joining him as well. The tier one in the middle. And Dream and Leprechauns, pretty much the same. They're looking for the cross down towards the K6, K7 area. If they don't get it, and then they're going to have to try and probably either go towards that green zone or maybe deal with the city push. But from the north, it's very hard to play for the city. It just isn't a good place to be, because you're not hull down. You can see Killipit's position here. How do you push against that? It's just impossible. He'll be a god in that position. Every single shot will penetrate. He'll be hull down. He'll be invincible by any normal man. Only really the top players could take him out. If FK Kishnitz will head in on the flank, Kirex already receiving a shell.
Yeah, Killer Pit, as you said, in such a great spot there, just catching Kirok straight on the cross. Very little to be done when someone's in such a dominant position. But we are seeing Message and Yuhu considering their options down by the 5-6 line. Once again, no massive commitment from either of these guys. I think Jack's trying to escape the map, actually, but still just about sticking in. But 8 minutes and 30 seconds to do something here. Really, the only player, barring Killer Pit, to make an appearance is the Lux there in the tier one, just down by the 5 line. And here comes a swing and rotate, probably out towards the green zone, I expect, or maybe joining in by Message. But at the moment, it looks like the Leprechauns are trying to get their rotate on and trying to find a better position.
So this is the standard tactic from in Ensk from the north. You basically get the IS3 in the middle, goes hull down, and then you try and get the cross shots consistently. 5100s come from the flank or from the middle area, the green zone or the middle area, obviously down those railroads, and basically just provide the firepower to your IS3's hull down strength. But Wusa are reading it pretty quickly. You can see they're heading back around towards their cap. I'm going to be probably taking up some defensive positions. I can only know that because FKK Schnitzel is sitting up right there. Looks for Message, doesn't find it. Message does have the reply though, 400 damage onto FKK.
Nice work from Message, actually. Does get the second shot up, but the first one to connect. You can see him still toying with this idea. Killipit, the man who did the early damage, Knockdown, that shell just whisks past. You can see the destruction that that's caused. So message with instant reactions, but excuse me, we are seeing slowly but surely these guys edging towards making a push. Snake Guy Finn might be joining message, and I haven't seen someone actually making a playthrough here. Normally they'd get caught through this normal square, but I'm interested if he actually goes for the commit here. He might actually edge across. Not sure if there's anyone there to challenge, but it's quite a risky position, but still. Message trying to find out against Schnitzel. We saw who got the early damage done, but Message just crosses over. Maybe trying to draw one of the opponents out, but not too much damage caused. And I've got to say, the Leprechaun's taking this one quite nicely so far, but they still need to make this one really count.
Well, look, they're doing it right because they can't deal with FKK Schnitzel with one IS-3. They need two IS-3s. Message just hit it, though. FKK Schnitzel doesn't get away with that one. Oh, and a third one landing onto FKK from the Snake Guy Finn. And I think FKK is down. He only needs that 11 seconds reload from these IS-3s. He's going to have to retreat. Just bouncing off the top of that turret.
Yeah, and this might be starting to make the move here for the Leprechauns. Already Jack is starting to join the others. Yuhu is just crossing that one off, making sure no one's going to make a counter push across the courtyard. Snake Guy Finn still holding it down. He did hit a vital shot to join him with Message and take Schnitzel very low. And as soon as we see this player fall, generally we'll start seeing a push. Schnitzel will be that player. If he does go down, there might be a bit of movement coming out from the Leprechauns. At the moment, it does seem as though Wusa are being the more passive side here, but then again, it's kind of grown to be expected at this point. But still, we're going to see if there's any more commitment. Siege has shown up. More targets, possibly for the Leprechauns, or just more of a threat. Kirex watching the back, the man who took the early damage. Jack moving in, we saw him earlier, making his way forward. And at the moment, tentative commitment from the Leprechauns, yet to fully come in. And look at that, Kyuki and Comandante already getting themselves into a good defensive spot. If Message moves too far, and he's completely unaware of this, he could get caught out. Jack does receive one while he tries to join his buddy there. I think Jack actually got tracked. No, he didn't. He's just kind of taking his time and doesn't want to go over just yet. And actually, QQ does get spotted out by Sensei in the Tier 1. So good work from him, making sure all the information is coming, flooding through. Message goes for the first shot. QQ backs away. Comandante is there. Did not expect Comandante to get that shell. Message goes a little lower. Maybe the Leprechauns have kind of hit their head against a brick wall now.
Message also losing his Amorek, so that's his first aid kit blown, or been blown beforehand for repairing something as he went against FKK Schnitzel. But Wusa, you can see, haven't really done anything with the little bit of advantage they got here. A lot of damage onto Drooling Leprechauns, only FKK Schnitzel taking a little bit. But still, they're sitting back like Lucky Cracky did, and that wasn't a particularly successful tactic against Kazuna Crew. Juhu now coming in through. You can see he's spotted, and he's found a pretty good position, although not so good as he does take 678 HP.
Yeah, great position to be in if he did manage to get there unspotted, but at the moment he's amongst the wolves pretty much, and he's going to get the information, but as you said, taking a lot of damage for that. And looking at the overall HP pool for the Leprechauns, it's not looking too pretty, to be fair. Schnitzel is low, but he's still a gun in the game, as we constantly mention. And so far, the focus fire was good for the Leprechauns until they kind of lost track of one of them. And at the moment, we still want to see if anyone's going to make a move. 4 minutes left. Is it going to happen?
FKK Schnitzel's going forwards. I think he's just drawing QQ. It has to come from QQ, I believe, or Comandante. Those 50 runners have to be in this game. Wuxia can really do anything they want. It's frustrating for me to watch because look how much, if you look at the side of Drooling Leprechauns, all their tanks are sitting towards the side. Look at QQ. He can drive up here, he can drive here, and he can go here completely unspotted. He can get any flank he wants. I have no idea why Commandant hasn't joined him either. As long as you have the IS-3s hold down and you can still get QQ to support them along this road, you're laughing, and Drooling Leprechauns are really crying as they can't actually take the last game. But it's Wusa being once again too tentative, not exactly sure what they're scared of, but obviously we have a 20/20 vision. We can see both teams, which does give you a huge advantage, to be honest. But Dream Leprechauns will eventually work Wusa down if they don't make it.
Yeah, and the Leprechauns have got a nice position here with Snake Guy Finn. At least he can keep a little bit of a glimpse on towards the opponents. He needs to be a little bit careful, though. He is being caught out here, and actually being caught out quite drastically from the side. Finally, QQ comes into the battle, does the job you wanted to see him do a little earlier, and that's going to force the hand from the Leprechauns. They cannot sit back now. Cap time is on. Message moves in. Jack moves in. Here comes the counterplay, though. Can Killer Pit take down Yuhu? Hopefully he can land the next couple of shells. He certainly needs to. Siege now makes his way forward. Comandante finds Sensei. Siege is the closest one, but Yuhu now has to be careful. He's not careful enough. Siege comes around on the side. And now Message still in the cab with Jack. Can they manage to defend this against three? Message lands the first towards QQ. Jack waiting for Seesh. Killer Pit finds Message though. Message a little low here. This is not looking good. Kirex is nowhere near either. He's sitting way further back. It's not a good position. Message is less than a one shot pretty much. He is in severe trouble now. Killer Pit moving in from the side. 45 seconds. Roofy does take down Muppety. And now Message backs out, but not enough. Comandante moves in. Jack next on the chopping block. One more shell will do the job towards him. And well, I don't think he's going to escape this one at all. They're being flooded by the Wooster side. And this is not looking good. Jack goes down. Kirex joins him. And the tentative Leprechauns have fumbled again. And Wooster walk away with another map under their belt.
Good stuff from Wooster. I said they should actually make that move first. It was very good. They actually reacted really well, and I think the good push in, knowing what to do with Druid Leprechauns pushing into the cap. But this could have been done so much earlier. QQ should have been going
you
up
said,
that road.
Yeah.
You know, the reason why they won that map is because the IS-3 was spotted. That was a mistake from Druid Leprechauns. That was an initiative move from Wooster. You know, they could have actually gone forwards with the 5100s, flanked around, come from behind, and win the game like that. They didn't need that IS-3 to be out of position and trying to flank around for no reason. To actually win that map. But all in all, a good, solid performance by Wooster. I think, you know, the way they came into the cap, they had everyone collapse in at the same time. They knew what tanks to shoot at what time. But again, I think they need to be a little bit better. For Druid Leprechauns, they just got kind of caught out with that IS-3. I think they should have been a little bit more going forwards, use the tier ones a little bit more effectively, put them in the cap and basically just get that pressure on.
Yeah, and Schnitz is saying GG, I suck. Bless him. But still, I've got to say, overall, the Leprechauns didn't really have an overall plan, I feel. It was a little bit lacking of that final execution, looking a little bit stale. And you did pretty much, you know, plan out how Wooster should undo them one by one by one, and it's exactly what happened. But we are going to have to make sure that we do find out the final score towards this, as the last map should be played out, I believe.
Yep.
For the money for the draws. But still, overall, this is a victory for Wooster regardless. There's not much that can be said or done. But, you know, at the end of the day, I don't think the Leprechauns can pretty much bring themselves back into this, in complete honesty. I think they're kind of done and dusted with this game. They looked like they didn't know how to end that one out. They made a good couple of first moves. You know, give them credit there. They made a good couple of first moves. They were, you know, pushing down that six, you know, the middle lines there, down the railroads. And they tested things out. They tried to make a play, but they just didn't have that end push, that end kind of reasoning to get involved. And it just never quite came through.
Yeah, just wanting a little bit more thinking, and they could have done the same thing as Wooster. Actually, they could have sent the AMX 5100 up and around just come from behind onto Wooster. Both these teams had the same option. Neither of them actually used it. It took a mistake, a significant mistake from one of them, for them to win. That's the difference here at the end of the day. And we'll move on to our next map. It has to be played out only if it's a team gets 3-0 that we don't actually play it. It doesn't matter if it's 3-0 in a row or
we just want to stop Wooster from being able to watch the Germany
game. If it's 2 and a draw and 3, exactly, that's what we want to do.
That's what you get for being passive on the first 3 maps.
Exactly.
You don't get to watch football.
You only get to play 3 maps if you get 3 maps. You know, we have the mini league, we have prize money to think about. There's a lot of things why we don't play just one more, why we don't just end it here at 2-0. It's simple as that. We want these teams to be playing these games. And obviously, it's a big change for us. In the previous seasons, we just had, if you got 3 in a row, you win. Simple as that. We used to play the round and the map and again.
Yep.
And then the first team to 3 won it, which I don't think is flexible enough. And obviously, one of the reasons why I changed it.
Yeah, I don't miss casting Prokhorovka 7 times in a row.
Yeah.
I love the map,
that
don't get me wrong.
That was insane.
But that was a treat. So I'm glad that's been adapted.
As am I.
Yeah, I think all of us. If ever you were around in, was that season?
Season
three,
two, I think.
Two or three.
Yeah.
One of the finals. It was. I think it was 7 maps.
No, it wasn't the finals. I think it was. Might have been a finals.
It was. It was the offline finals. 7 maps on Prokhorovka. Melly's even. She's like, I remember that.
We were there.
Yeah. The Polish guys. Who was it? Who actually did that in the end? I'm trying to think back to who it was coming out. I have a horrible feeling it was like Mouse Sports or something. Against Evil Panda Squad, maybe.
I can't remember what it was. It
escapes
me, but
7 draws on one map.
We were talking absolute drivel by the end of it.
There's only so much analysis and play-by-play you can bring when they're just parked in bushes.
Bushes, yeah.
That's the truth.
You pretty much did all the analysis and play-by-play you can do on that, really.
You're kind of stuck
then
down
Then we go
there.
To food and spaghetti bolognese. That's pretty
no
much
No one guessed what our favourite food was, by the
I
way.
Know, that's
no one actually got that right. Like, I've got a couple of the VIP cards still left, and if anyone had got them, they would have got that, but...
But, no.
So the
cookie
should have
gone back through the vodka.
They should have. That
would
have been
the
smart
thing.
And also
the one which Mitch ate, which was a lemon, live on air.
That was beautiful.
God, that was
majestic.
Brilliant. That was amazing.
I was horrified. Like,
the pesticides on that thing. Unwashed lemon. What was he thinking?
He's Australian.
Strapping lad like him.
They don't care. I eat spiders and weird things. But no, it was an interesting time. But yeah, normally I have, you know, lemons at an event for when my throat goes ridiculously messed up because we've been casting for hours on end. So yeah. Like hot water, lemon, and sugar.
Yeah, it works a treat.
Nails it. But, you know, my lemon got eaten by some Australian over at the side. He was just like, this is my favourite food. With the peel on. He didn't even
Disgusting.
Peel. I was horrified.
He spit that out afterwards, which you didn't see on camera, by the way, guys.
Well, he didn't eat it.
No, well, he didn't swallow it. Oh, he might have done. Yeah, he did, didn't he?
He did. Melly's just like, I was with him. I was near the monstrosity. Bum, bum, bum. It was pretty atrocious. Let's be serious here. It was slightly terrifying. Never going to go to Australia is what I got from that. Never head in there. a little too scared, but still, I think we are just waiting on the final map. It's going to be Ruinberg.
Yep.
Once teams are ready, we'll get underway so we can see the final scoreline through and through. But in this one, I have no idea what we're going to see because these two teams are now just kind of... I feel that the Leprechauns are kind of out of this mentally. Mm. They've already lost the game. I don't think they're going to be in the best mindset.
I think they're just going to charge in, to be honest.
I don't know if that's the lineup they're going with. I'm assuming maybe they've just not changed yet, but... I don't know.
They've changed. Triple 5100 IS3, MX3090 is different. And for Wusa, triple MX3090, double 110. I hope these guys actually go for a brawl instead of camping, because there's no point in camping at this point.
Well, there's no point going to the final map to try and decide who has the least amount of draws to earn the most money by drawing it out. That's the least logical way you can go about this, teams.
Well, Wusa's got a Germany game to win. To win. Probably lose. France, France won at least.
It's who good. Are they against? Algeria.
Yeah.
Ugh. I don't know.
What was that? Oh.
It's not exactly a big opponent, is it? Let's have a little look.
They also
0-0 so far.
Nor was Mexico yesterday in Netherlands, but still a pretty good game.
There was a disallowed goal for being offside. That's pretty close.
Is it already side?
Yeah, 19 minutes in the game.
Okay.
So let's get this one going, guys. Wusa is just like, I'm going to take my time. But anyway, we are ready for that final map. Let's get underway into Ruinberg. Alrighty, so welcome into battle number 5. This is to find out the final scoreline, let's say it that way, in the north in red it's the Leprechauns, in the south in blue it's Wusa, and they have won with two maps. Whether it be 2-0 or 2-1, we're yet to find out, and I'm sure we will very quickly. So in the north it will be the Leprechauns, in the south Wusa. So take us into what we're seeing so far.
It looks like Wusa are going for the middle brawl straight away. Sieg, Terrasans, who's 3 MX1390 Rufy as well, straight towards the village. The two 110s they've got heading and towards the village area as well. The T1's obviously towards the city, and Dream Leprechaun's doing very much of the same, just charging across that open field, so we probably get an early engagement in the middle area. FKK Schnitzel might be in the better position there. You can see the 110 has got a lot of frontal armor, which will be very hard for Dream Leprechauns to deal with, but those 250-100s are actually on the higher ground.
Yeah, but Yuhu has already taken one shell, make it two now. He's in a little bit of trouble here, being caught out early on message as well. This is not looking good for the Leprechauns. They're already taking a bit of a beating. Rufy finally gets a reply, but look how low these guys are. 6-9-4 and 4-2-2, as they're now being surrounded by the opposition. Schnitzel, Comandante, Seash all moving to place. Only a little bit of damage on the cross so far. Schnitzel gets a touch on the side, but it's Rufy who's down the lowest, down to 5-4-2. But where's the engagement going to come down to? Let's have a keep our eyes on this one. The 2 5100s out on a limb here. Snake Guy Finn chimes in with a shot towards Commandante. Juhu goes very low. One more shell for him will take him out of the game, but Schnitzel moving in. This could be a risky play, to be fair. They have to be a little careful, but Schnitzel on the cross doesn't land the shot. He takes a lot of the damage, but can they finally take down Juhu? No! Oh my word! The Leprechaun's back-to-back kills coming through. Commandante finally takes down Juhu, but this is not looking too pretty so far for Wusa either. Terristan does find Jack, and now Message trying to make these shells count, but Terristan is low. He's on fire, he's burning, but Commandante finds Message first. And now this is not going to go very well for the Leprechauns.
Commandante doing a great job. He's hull down. He might find the Kempi there. Snake Guy Finn does dispatch him, although, and well, Wusa might be on reload, but Commandante is not in an autoloader, so he can do plenty of damage from that middle.
Yeah, and Snake Guy Finn has literally the uphill struggle against him. He does find one, but he gets one back, and he's a little worse for wear, as we are seeing now finally the fire from the side from Rufy coming into play. Snake Guy Finn, not in the best position, out in the open, taken down the end by Commandante, as Kempi, the last man really able to do anything in this situation, which is, I don't know, he can't do much. Let's be serious here. Commandante still on 7-6-8, Rufy 5-4-2, and Terristan 1-1-2, but you know, there's a lot of guns in the game for the Wusa side.
To at least two more guns in the game. Sensei is not really a gun, the 20mm Spano. Commandante does manage to miss that shot against Sensei. A little bit unfortunate, but Rufy does find Kempi.
Yeah, Kempi not in the best position either, being caught out two shells in a row. Commandante's found Sensei. It's just Kempi now, and he gets rammed out of the game. Finally, Wusa go aggressive. Chalk it up to football, chalk it up to what you want, but that is a 3-0 victory in the end for the boys.
Yeah, good result for them. The first 3-0 they got of the league, yeah. Although it was in the last map, so we did have two draws in there, of course.
Yeah.
But a well-deserved result. I think both teams need to improve on their general tank skills, but
completely
for sure,
agree.
Wusa are going up. Junior Leprechauns a little bit shaky. They might head down. They might just get themselves back in a little bit more positive mindset and position. But Wusa, at least two wins back-to-back, a good result for them here. But they make so many mistakes. We saw Sieg miss that shell around the corner. You know, you can't miss those shells. You should be playing 100% and making sure you understand where your server-side reticle is so you don't end up hitting the wall next to you.
Mistakes have been made, but in the end, Wusa pick up the win. So certainly well needed for them. They're not looking too good in the overall standings, but will help them out in the end, picking up a solid victory. Well, solid enough. Anyway, what did you guys think at home? That's the big question for me. Melly, what did they think? Did they predict it right?
Yeah, the vote was pretty much in Team Wusa's favor with around 70%, if
wow.
I'm not mistaken.
That's very one-sided.
Yeah, definitely. And if we have a look in the comment section, you see that people actually predicted on drilling Leprechauns picking up at least one or two maps.
You had faith in the Finns. We apologize.
Exactly. But overall, I see some right comments. I will pick the winners, of course, after the show. And also, the tweets of today will be rewarded as well. So thank you for getting involved. Thank you for taking part in our challenges and for tweeting and talking to us in Twitch chat and wherever the power of the internet allows you to talk to us. And yeah, that's all from my side. Thank you for getting involved.
Yeah, it was nice having you here, obviously, Melly. And we'll be seeing you next week. And speaking of next week, or next play day, should I say, we have probably some of the best games that I've been waiting to see for quite some time. Let's ignore this play day from top to bottom. I don't even care. It's over now. But the next one is the one you want to be watching. And I can tell you a couple of games as to why. The first one, the first game we start off with, TCM up against Virtus Pro. That is going to be massive. Following that, EPS up against Schoolbus. Another brilliant game. And then even following, Denial against Cplay. Three phenomenal games, and you can see the impact that might have on the rankings. Let's bring that one up there for you guys at home. First Pro still at the top, but TCM need a victory. Two draws is not good enough. Schoolbus and EPS, they're pretty much near on tied on points. One draw is the difference to one loss. Whoever pretty much gets this one, if it's a victory, will start chipping their way ahead of the other. And then even Denial and Cplay, let's look at how this is going for Denial. Not very well. Cplay, if they get a victory, they could almost get up to the same points as them. So this could change everything within this ranking system. And that is what we want to see here. This is the important factor. And I've got to ask you the question, what is your standout game from the next play day?
It's the battle for third place, basically. And I think my one is Evil Panel Squad versus Schoolbus. TCM versus Virtus Pro, a little bit more towards Virtus Pro.
I agree.
But School Bus and Evil Panda Squad, very close teams. And I said, you know, School Bus, TCM Gaming, Evil Panda Squad, all vying for that third spot. And the moment School Bus has it, but they're so close in points, an extra three for either one of them will take it.
Big games coming up, and as I said, it is going to be within this week. It's going to be on Thursday, the 3rd of July, just into the brand new month, so do make sure you tune back in at the exact same time. We'll be there, but make sure you follow on Twitch TV just to make sure you get notified when we go live. Obviously, the follow button just down below will let you know, but guys, we will be there. As I said, Melly will even be joining us, so do make sure you tune back in there. We'll hope to see you soon.